Hey folks, welcome to Digimento Education. Welcome to yet another interesting video on electronic devices and circuits. This is EDC lecture 18. I am a course instructor, Utkarsh Upadhyay. Hopefully you all are doing great and continuously revising the concepts that I covered in the past 17 lectures. If you haven't gone through them, I would suggest you to go through them first and then hop on to this particular video. And this will basically help you building your concepts stronger. Okay, building your concepts and making them stronger. If you really like the video, please hit the like button, share and subscribe to our channel and write down your comments below in the comment section. So in this video, we will be talking about different type of diodes, different types of diode. The first one that we are going to discuss about is LED, which is light emitting diode. Let's just quickly talk about that. What is an LED? An LED is just a simple diode and it is basically used to emit the light, any colored light or IR light. The semiconductor is not silicon or germanium. It's not an element type semiconductor. The semiconductor uses compound type semiconductor. For example, gallium arsenide, which is a direct band gap semiconductor, gallium arsenide phosphide or gallium phosphide. Okay, so for example, this is basically let's say a PN junction diode, and this is basically a depletion region. Let's say this is an LED, and you can consider to be a gallium arsenide or gallium phosphide or gallium arsenide phosphide, whatever you want to take it as. Take it. So always remember that the diode. For the diode to basically emit the light needs to be forward biased, needs to be connected with the potential which basically forward biases the PN junction diode. What happens is that in the forward bias, when the diode is basically under forward biasing, the holes and the holes from the P side, which are the majority charge carriers, and the electrons from the N side, which are the majority charge carriers on N side, move towards the junction. And whatever what happens is that when the hole and electrons combine with each other, the energy is released in the form of light. That energy basically corresponds to the energy of a photon. Okay, that and for that energy to be emitted out from the junction of a PN junction diode, the energy of the photon needs to be greater than the energy band gap of the semiconductor. Okay, the principle which your LED works on is known as electroluminescence. Okay, remember that DBGSC, direct bandgap semiconductors, are used for that. For example, gallium arsenide, gallium phosphide, gallium arsenide phosphide, they're compound type semiconductors. Okay, visible region, in the visible region, the lights emitted, lights can be lights like red, green, orange, yellow, white, amber, can be released. Okay, so we have a critical wavelength, as we already discussed, that critical wavelength is equal to 1.24 by EG. EG is the energy band gap, micrometer. So these are the parameters that you need to consider before studying about the light emitting diode. And the energy of the photon needs to be greater than the energy band gap, then only the photons can be released or the light can be released. Do not say the energy is released in the form of heat. The heat basically corresponds to the release of phonons, and for that we use element type semiconductors. Element type semiconductors are used to release the heat, that are the phonons, while photons can be released by the light emitting diode, which are basically the gallium arsenide or gallium arsenide phosphide or gallium phosphide. Okay. I think this part is clearer to you. Now, there are some points related to the light emitting diode. Let's just quickly go through that, to go through these points. Actually, your type of diodes is not that important for gate, but it is important for IES and other PSU examinations, and you won't expect a hell lot of questions asked from this particular topic. So I am just giving you a highlight of what actually these diodes are and what are their properties. So let's just quickly go through the points written here about the light emitting diode. Gallium arsenide emits infrared light and gallium arsenide phosphide emits orange light or yellow light. Gallium phosphide basically emits green or red light. Principle is, it works on the principle of electroluminescence, which is basically the conversion of electrical energy into the light energy. It is always operated in the forward biasing. That's important. It's always operated in the forward biasing. If you basically operate it in reverse biasing, it works as a normal diode. Light is emitted due to large number of recombinations taking place at the junction. This is important. It is always basically fabricated with direct band gap semiconductors. It can emit light either in visible or invisible region of spectrum of light depending upon the type of the material used. Infrared light is used in the TV remote. As you can see, if you just place your camera in front of the remote and if you press any button on the remote, you can see the infrared light blinking at the tip of the remote. The color of the emitted light depends on the wavelength and the frequency of the light, type and concentration of the dopant. This is important. You should know the dependency of the color that is emitted by the light emitting diode. The efficiency of the LED is proportional to forward current and inversely proportional to the temperature. When reverse biased, it works as a normal diode. Cut-in voltage ranges from 1.3 volt to 1.5 volt. And dissipated power of the order dissipated power is of the order of milliwatt. Response time is microseconds. It is faster than LCDs. LCDs have response time in milliseconds, and power dissipated is of the order of microwatt. Large carry lifetime, which is used in LEDs are used in remote control transmitter as a display device and designing of optocouplers. So these are some important points that you can keep in your mind for solving some small questions, one mark questions, for mass theoretical questions asked in the gate or in the IES examination. But you cannot expect the questions to be asked from this topic in the gate. Let's move on to another type of diode. Let's have a look at the VARACTOR diode. VARACTOR diode is basically a linear graded diode. Principle is transition capacitance CT. So CT is proportional to V to the power minus N, and for graded diode, for graded PN junction, N should be equal to 1 by 3. N is basically the graded coefficient. CT should be proportional to 1 by VR square cube root of VRB. Okay, as we already discussed earlier, it is always operated in the reverse biasing mode. That's one thing to understand. This is the VARACTOR diode characteristics, which is basically the capacitance voltage characteristics, or you can say the CV characteristics of VARACTOR diode. Okay, this is like this. So you can see with the change in the reverse bias voltage, the capacitance, the transition capacitance is also changing. So for a smaller variation in reverse bias voltage, we get minute variation in the transition capacitance, which is of few picofarads. And due to this, VARACTOR diode is also widely used for frequency tuning of receivers. VARACTOR diode is also called as a variable capacitor or VARCAP. That's basically the terminology. There are basically multiple terminologies to denote VARACTOR diode. This is a symbol of a VARACTOR diode, a diode symbol, and a capacitor, a variable capacitor symbol. It is basically equivalent to the series combination of the ohmic resistance, which needs to be smaller for better performance, and the transition capacitance. This is RR, which is the reverse resistance of the VARACTOR diode, which is about 1 mega ohm. Okay. So, popular use material is gallium arsenide. Also, the direct bandgap semiconductor is used in this case. Application, this is important for IES, this is not for GATE. GATE has never asked the questions from this particular topic, so you don't need to worry about that. But you need to worry about this thing for if you are preparing for IES. It's important with respect to IES. For direct generation of FM by using VARACTOR diode, modulator and circuit, designing of voltage control oscillators, or for automatic tuning of LC resonant circuits, as a para amplifier, which is also a low noise microwave power amplifier, which is used in satellite communication. This is all about your VARACTOR diode. Let's move on to the next diode type. Let's have a look at another type of diode. It's a point contact diode, which is basically a metal semiconductor junction diode. This is a semiconductor, and this is a basically a metal whisker, which it is also worth noting that this point contact diode has zero junction capacitance. Okay, so the metal is basically a silver coated tungsten wire which is of micrometer thickness and is of the form of a cat whisker. Okay, area of contact is nearly negligible, and high melting point, tungsten has high melting point, which nearly about around 2000 Kelvin. CJ junction capacitance, A epsilon upon W. Since A is very very small, your junction capacitance is also small. As A is small, so CJ is also small. Okay, let's have a look at another type of diode. The next type of diode that we are going to talk about is basically a step gated diode or an abrupt PN junction diode. Okay, as it's quite clear from the name itself that the junction is basically abrupt, which means that there is a doping concentration gradient from P side to N side, or from N side to P side. Okay, so on one side doping is quite high than on the other side. So this is designed with abrupt PN junction. Okay, this is designed with abrupt PN junction. In this case, your NA is not equal to ND. Either your NA is far greater than ND or vice versa. For example, you have P plus N type semiconductor diode or PN plus type of junctions. Okay, this topic is important with respect to GATE and IES both. So depletion layer, depletion region penetrates more towards less doped side. Okay, so if we just see for P plus N junction, the penetration will be more towards N side than on P side, and in PN plus the penetration will be more towards P side than on N side. Okay, if we consider three different cases, considering P plus N junction, okay, we know when nothing is connected to the diode, no voltage source is connected, no external voltage is connected to the diode, no biasing is applied when the diode is in equilibrium, so the equation of width of the depletion region is this. Okay, let's say for P plus N junction, NA is far greater than ND, or you can say that NA is greater than 10 times of ND. Okay, so if your NA increases, your width of the depletion region decreases. We know that W is equal to WP plus WN, and we know that WP is W into ND by NA plus ND. So if your NA increases, your WP decreases. This implies that WP is less than WN. Understood. And since NA is far greater than ND, we can say that W is nearly equal to WN. Understood. WP is nearly equal to WN. Since WP is far smaller than WN, as WP is far smaller than WN, so we can say W is nearly equal to WN. Okay, so in a PN junction, in a PN junction diode, if doping concentration are doping concentrations are increased on one side, then your total width of depletion region decreases, and depletion width on highly doped side reduces. Okay, depletion width on the highly doped side reduces, and depletion width on lightly doped side increases. Are these points clear? Let's move on to the second case, when P plus N junction diode is reverse biased. When it is reverse biased, so your width will be equal to 2 epsilon by Q, 1 by Na plus 1 by Nd into Vj. Okay? Since Na is far greater than Nd, okay, so 1 by Na will be far less than 1 by Nd. It's clear. So W will be approximately equal to Wn. So this equation boils down to W is equal to Wn square root of 2 epsilon by Q. We can neglect 1 by Na in front of 1 by Nd. So we can say it's equal to 1 by Nt into Vj. Okay? So your Wn will be equal to 2 epsilon Vj upon Qnd. And from here, we can calculate Vj, or the junction potential. Junction potential, which comes out to be Qnd Wn square upon 2 epsilon volts. This is your Vj. This is how you are expected to do the approximations. Let's move on to the third case. Considering PN plus junction diode. Okay, considering PN plus junction diode, so in this case you will have Nd far greater than Na, so W will basically be approximately equal to Wp. Okay, so if you just see the PN plus junction diode, this is P, this is N plus, the depletion width will be more towards the P side than on N side. Okay, this is WP, this is WN. Okay? Understood. So in this case, you have ND far greater than NA. And when PN plus junction diode is reverse biased, when PN plus diode is reverse biased, so Nd, since Nd is very very greater than Na, so 1 by Nd will be very very less than 1 by Na, so W will be nearly equal to Wp, will be equal to 2 epsilon by Q, 1 by Na into Vj. It's quite tacit now. So Vj, by rearranging the equation, we can calculate Vj will be equal to Q into Na into W square divided by 2 epsilon. This is how it goes. Let's move on to the fifth point of discussion, the charge density diagram and field intensity of a step graded diode. So note that CT is proportional to V to the power minus N, where N will be equal to 1 by 2 in this case. Okay. Now let's draw the charge density diagram of this diode. Any interviewer, the interviewer may ask you to draw the charge density diagram or the electric field intensity diagram of an abrupt P-N junction diode. So you should know how to, you should not go blank when the interviewer throws this type of question to you. Okay, don't feel blank and don't feel confused at that time, otherwise you are doomed. We are drawing for P plus N junction diode. Okay, so let's say this is reverse bias, let's say this is plus, this is minus, and the potential here will be Vj. Okay, negative immobile ions are present here and positive immobile ions are present here. This is Wp, this is Wn. Let's draw the charge density diagram and then the electric field intensity diagram. Just remember that the electric field intensity will always be maximum at the junction, not anywhere inside the junction, not anywhere inside the depletion region. It is maximum, it is always maximum at the junction. So if you draw the charge density diagram, let's just have a look at that. Just draw it. First of all, draw the diode. Then negative immobile ions are present here. It will be zero beyond the depletion region and will be negative here in the P region. In the P region will be positive on the N side. Okay. Let's say the area of this thing is A2, the area of this thing is A1. Keep in your mind that A1 should be equal to A2. Charge densities should always be equal on either side of the junction. As we have already studied about, and we already studied about the charge equality equation, which says Wn into Nd should be equal to Wp into Na. In order to satisfy this equation, A1 needs to be equal to A2. Okay, this is zero level. And electric field intensity, since it is a PN junction, electric field intensity will be negative and maximum. So if we just have a look at that, it will be zero beyond the depletion region, will be maximum at the junction. Okay, you can see, and will be minimum at the edges. This is your E max. This is zero here, it will be E max. Electric field intensity will be in this direction. Okay, this is electric field. Electric field intensity. And this is charge density. Okay, understood. So, E, electric field intensity, is equal to minus Vj by W, minus Vj by W. So E max will be equal to minus Vj by W by 2. So this comes out to be equal to minus 2 times of V naught plus VRB by W. So this is something we already derived earlier, volt per meter. This maximum electric field intensity can also be calculated using Poisson's equation, but there will be an error of plus minus 15%, and which is basically acceptable. So you should note it down that Emax can be calculated, can also be calculated using Poisson's equation but there will be an error of plus minus 15% which is acceptable. Okay? Let's discuss another type of diode, which is basically known as a tunnel diode. This is only for IES, not for gate. You don't need to study about study it for gate if you are aiming for gate, but you should study if you are aiming for IES. It is also known as Isaki diode. It has very high doping concentration on either side of the junction, so depletion width is very, very small as a result, which is of the order of 100 angstrom to 200 angstrom. So you can see this is a PN junction diode in which doping concentrations are very, very high, so the depletion width is very, very small. So it is so both the sides are doped of, in the ratio of 1:10^3, which is basically heavily doped semiconductor. This tunnel diode exhibits a tunneling effect. The symbol is this. Okay, it has fastest switching operation. Switching time is about is of the order of picoseconds. This is also known as a negative resistance device or minus R device. Generally made up of gallium arsenide or the direct bandgap semiconductors. It is a P plus N plus junction diode. Okay. Advantages of this diode is that it is smaller in size, easier to fabricate, cheap, low power dissipation, and offers very high resistance to radiation. There's some disadvantages of that as well. Because of being a two terminal device, there is no DC isolation between output and input sections. It also has smaller voltage swings. Okay. So as I already mentioned that it exhibits tunneling effect. So what tunnel effect actually is the definition is this. Tunnel diode has very narrow depletion width, nearly of the order of 1/50th of the wavelength of the visible light, and therefore charges penetrate depletion region with almost at the speed of light, and this property is called as tunneling effect. The movement of the charge carriers across the junction at the speed of light is what referred to as tunneling effect. Now let's discuss about the IV characteristics of the tunnel diode. Note down that cut-in voltage of the tunnel diode is 0 volts. Okay. So, under reverse bias, tunnel diode works as a linear device. So, if we just have a look at, this is the IV characteristics of the diode. Okay. This red line shows the ohmic region that the tunnel diode exhibits, that occurs for the voltages less than the peak voltage value. Okay, in this voltage range VP to VV, the device enters into a negative R region. Okay, and this is where it is actually used in. This is the region where the tunnel diode is actually used in, and the Q point or the operating point is always kept within this range from VP to VV. This is symbolized in negative R region, implies that if we increase the voltage, current decreases. After VV, on increasing the voltage, or increasing the forward bias voltage greater than the valley voltage, the diode acts as a normal diode. Okay, it's an exponential device. It works as a normal. It has normal diode characteristics. Q is the operating point. Tunneling effect stops here. This is basically the ohmic region where it acts as a linear device or a resistor. Let's discuss it in details. Under reverse bias, tunnel diode works as a linear device, for example, resistor. In the exponential region, it works as a normal diode. Tunnel diode is generally operated in the negative R region. Minus R tunnel diode is due to the tunneling effect. This is all due to the tunneling effect. Minus R property of the diode can be used in designing of microwave oscillators, relaxation oscillator. Relaxation oscillator basically generates the sawtooth waveform. Okay, it exhibits negative property when the diode changes its state from on state to off, when forward voltage changes from VP to VV. VP is peak voltage, VV is valley voltage. VP is peak voltage and VV is valley voltage. Okay, tunnel diode is a voltage control device. Except BJT, every other device is voltage control device. BJT is a current control device. Is the only device which is current controlled. For its best operation, Q point or the operating point should always lie in the negative resistance region. For best performance, the requirements are larger IP by IV ratio, which is nearly 15 for gallium arsenide, 7.5 for germanium and 2.5 for silicon. That's why germanium silicon are not preferred for fabrication of tunnel diodes. That's why gallium arsenide is only preferred. Larger voltage swing VF minus VP, fabricated mostly with gallium arsenide. Tunnel diode exhibits multi-featured property or a triple-valued property. That is, any value of forward current between IP and IV can be obtained with three different sets of forward voltages. And due to this property, tunnel diode is more popular in designing of pulse circuit and industrial electronic circuits. Tunnel diode can be used in para amplifiers. Okay, so you can see that this is the IV characteristics of the diode, which I already explained. So hey folks, I'm stopping this lecture here. I will discuss more on this in the next video lecture. I will discuss about Zener diode, which is important with respect to gate and IES, solar cells and Schottky diodes. These three diodes are very, very important with respect to gate, for gate and IES. So I will cover in the next video lecture. See you in the next video. Thank you very much.